Welcome to the Seismic Diaphragm Design Lecture. The example I'm going to do comes out of the book that Brian and I have written, Post-Tension Concrete Principles and Practice. This example is actually chapter 12 of the book. So it's all about product placement. So here's the product. Here's the placement. You can't see the product, but you also can't see that I'm not wearing pants. I'm just kidding. I'm wearing pants. I needed something to hang the microphone transmitter from. So, as you can see on your screen, this will be the example that we will look at. I decided not to do a rectangular example. I put a notch in it to make it a little more exciting. Did make things easy on myself. I made all the shear walls 18 inches thick and 25 feet long, so their rigidities are the same. This is a four-story building. And for no particularly good reason, I loaded it up at the roof with more load, something like it's a plaza. The other three levels have the same seismic mass. Before we dive into that and jump right into diaphragm design and equations and forces from the code, I think it's very important to understand where the code gets its equations. Why are those the equations? And what are those equations trying to accomplish? If you watch any of my UCLA videos, you'll see that I'm pretty critical of the educational system throughout really the country and the world right now. I think computer programs have gotten so flashy. They're pretty sexy. They're exciting. You can rotate models. You can look at color output and three-dimensional this, that, and the other. But students tend to, I think, be overwhelmed when they see that and seem to think that the massive improvements in computer programs, input and output, really mean that the guts of what that computer program is doing is somehow also made those same leaps and bounds. That's just not true. Post-tension concrete design has not changed substantially in my entire career. Load factors have changed. Little things like that will change, but no significant changes. Programs certainly have, not the guts of post-tension concrete design though. Dynamic analysis, modal analysis with response spectrum haven't changed at all. Computer programs changed dramatically. The way it looks, dramatically different than the Fortran ETABS models that I was using back at Cal Poly, San Luis Obispo in the 1980s. But the guts of what is being done has not changed. And I really believe that students are graduating today without those real fundamentals and really believing that some things are just so complicated that they can't be covered in school. And that's frustrating to me. So I'm doing my best, my part, to try to rectify that. So before we launch into the example, in the book I thought it was important enough to actually develop the loads first using dynamic principles, because there's very few books that do that practically. You know, there's some complex dynamics books out there, but from a designer's perspective, I don't think there are a lot of books that simply show you the way Sat Rehal showed us it's done, you know, back in the 80s in his dynamics class at Cal Poly. So let's start here. For right now, keep your eyes above the line. You want to stay above the line, just like on Biggest Loser on TV. We want to be above the line right now. These are the two mode shapes. There are four mode shapes. There's four translational masses. I develop all of them in the book, but I quickly determined that the first two modes capture more than 90% of the seismic mass, and the code says you can stop there. That's all you need to consider. So that's what I've done. And I'm not going to go through that whole process. If you want to go through the book and see it done, it's there, and it's pretty straightforward and simple. But that's not the point of today's lecture. So start with mode shapes. Mode shape one, fundamental mode shape, often called. Mode shape two, corresponding mode one and mode two, period. This is the difficult part. This is what you need the computer for. There's tremendous amount of numbers, the eigenvalues and eigenvectors, and matrix analysis required to come up with this. You need a computer, you always have, and I would never be silly enough to try to state that this part should be done by hand. But once you have this, once you have the mode shapes, frequencies, and corresponding periods, from that point on, you can really do this by hand, and it is not difficult, as you can see in the book. So let's walk through what do you do, how does a designer approach this once the computer gives him or her this. You will come up with a participation function, a participation factor for each mode, a participation function, and through that, you will also go to the site-specific response spectra, pull out an acceleration value for that single degree of freedom system, and come up with story forces for mode 1. You do the same thing for mode 2. These are the mode 1 story forces in this example. This is completely elastic behavior. It doesn't include an R value, the ductility factor. It doesn't include scaling. All that will happen. Right now, this is just the pure response spectrum elastic set of forces. Those forces are not really critical. Those are not what we really care about when we're doing a global vertical distribution design of a building. We actually care much more about the story shears. And if you're just looking at code equations, it's not obvious that that's what we care about most. So the first thing you would do is calculate the story shears. That's what I've done here. Move over to the second mode. Find the second mode story forces. Those are not critical and really not actually even that useful. But they create story shears that become extremely important to us and to what the code's going to develop. So with these two sets of story shears, now we go below the line. We'll combine the story shears. You can combine them using the square root sum of the squares. You can decide that there's a more sophisticated way than that. That's a designer's choice. I've always been fine with the square root sum of the squares, close enough for government work, as they used to tell me. If I take the square root of the story shears, square root sum of the squares of those, these are what I get. At the roof, I square 9176 kips, add that to the square of 2714, take the square root of that. That's the maximum shear, analytically, from a statistics perspective, that I can anticipate. I take the shear at the fourth level, 13,020, square that, add that to the square of 780, take the square root of that, and I get the maximum story shear, and so forth, on down the building. Until I do the last level and I get the maximum realistic base shear that I can anticipate combining the modes. Now, what the code then does with this information is extract out the story forces. But the important thing about these forces are the set of forces that create the story shears that you want to design for. These are not necessarily forces that have been derived happening at each level. These are just the forces that get extracted out to make sure that you envelope the story shears. They are a set of forces. They are all happening at one time. This force by itself doesn't make any sense without also having all these other forces acting at the same time on the building. Now we're going to have to apply a ductility factor, and that's changed throughout my career. Funny thing is, the way you approach these things have changed many times. The answer is usually about the same each time, each code iteration. I've always thought that's somewhat funny. But out of that, we'll take this force as a percent of this base shear. So 57.1% of the force is going to be applied at the roof, 20.7% at the fourth, and so on and so forth down. But remember, this is a set of forces intended to envelope the story shears. These are the forces that will be used to design the entire seismic system, the shear walls, the moment frames, the brace frames, whatever it is that the seismic system is, and the foundations. The full set of forces acting simultaneously. But that's not what diaphragm design is about. The diaphragm design is not a set of forces. Diaphragm itself only cares about what's the maximum force that's going to be applied on it, not irrespective of what's happening above or below or anywhere else. So, I'll ask you, how would you take this same information, it's in there, and extract out the diaphragm forces? What would make sense to do? What would make sense to do is to take the square root, some of the squares, of the actual forces at each level to determine statistically what you believe the maximum combined modal effect story force would be, or just force at that level. So if I wanted to know, say at the third level, what the maximum diaphragm force would be using the modal properties, I would square 2215 with 3123, add those, take the square root. That would give me the mathematical approximation of the maximum force I would anticipate at that level. And that doesn't have anything to do with what's happening at any other level at that time. The current code du jour is ASCE7. How does it approximate those two different sets of forces? How does it come up with equations to do both of those things that I just described? The total vertical distribution set of forces to be used simultaneously, and also a set of equations or an equation that estimates the maximum diaphragm force at any single level. Well, the vertical distribution, the set of forces we're most used to thinking about and I think people are most comfortable with, is described by this equation. Now, this equation keeps changing form a little bit, but when you get to the guts of it, this really hasn't changed in my entire career, how this force distribution is applied. The only thing that's changed is we used to have a roof force factor if the period got long. Now we have Ks. Through the advancements of modern technology, we now have Ks applied to the H. We didn't have Ks before, but that's really the difference, the K. K usually hovers around 1, as you'd expect. So anyway, that's the full set of forces. The important thing to remember is that all these forces are acting and analyzed simultaneously. None of these forces really makes any sense being applied by itself. Diaphragm forces, on the other hand, a new equation. This equation has not changed in my entire career, the decades that I've been doing this. This is the equation that the code uses to estimate square root sum of the squares of the modal forces at each level. Not the modal shears, but the modal forces. As you will see in just a minute when I pull over the third board, this equation will result in higher forces at each level. That makes sense. These forces are not the highest forces you would anticipate at any level. It's the set that's going to give you the greatest, or envelope the story shears. These forces are not assumed to be acting simultaneously. Okay, maybe I've beaten that to death, but I really believe most students are graduating without a really good understanding of that. So I'm here to beat it into everybody. For our example, we're going to use the FPX equation. I've spared you a lot of the back work here. You can go through it, you can see it in the book, but this is the table, tabular representation of this equation, the FPX equation. The FPX equation says that at any level, if I want to know what the diaphragm force, the FPX force at that level, I add up all of the forces taken from the vertical distribution, add those up, divide those by the sum of all of the weights at and above that level. So I'd add up all of these, divide this sum by this sum, and then multiply by the seismic weight at that specific level. The seismic weight at that specific level would be this number. That is how FPX is arrived at. Now you will notice that the FPX force is always going to be substantially higher than the force from the vertical distribution, as it should be, as makes sense. Code being the code, we'll have you do all the work and then just say, I don't care what number you calculate, you're going to at least design for this number. And currently the code represents the minimum diaphragm force as 0.2 times the SDS factor times the importance factor times the weight at that particular level. In this diaphragm design example that we're going to do, we're going to do a design that works for the fourth, third, and second level. We are going to use the 1021 kip design force.
Here's the diaphragm again. We're looking at the fourth floor plan with the FP force placed at the center of mass, the 1021 kip force that we just calculated. Now, we use a resultant force placed at the center of mass in order to do what we always do, which is find reactions. Well, the reactions in this case will be the forces to the shear walls. But it's also important, because we're going to need to generate a shear diagram and a moment diagram, that we know how that load is distributed across the diaphragm. In a separate calculation, I've taken the 1021 kip force and divided it by the total area of the diaphragm and come up with 27.2 pounds per square foot. To create a line load, I multiply that by 150 feet in this larger portion and come up with 4.08 kips per foot. And likewise, on the smaller part of the diaphragm, I've calculated 2.72 kips per foot. Now, this may seem obvious, but the resultant force here and its location must correspond to the centroid of this load, of the distributed load, or statics will not be correct. That may seem like a painfully obvious statement to make, but there is a debate going on right now, and I will be honest with you. There are academics who are writing diaphragm design examples now, and some of them believe that this force needs to be shifted in accordance with the accidental torsion requirements of the code. Now, I disagree with that, and let's take a harder look at that. Here's the section of the ASCE7 code that's causing some of the controversy. It is the accidental torsion section of the code. Now, I completely agree that accidental torsion should be used where appropriate, where the code is telling you to actually use it. And what it says is that you take the calculated center of mass and move it plus and minus 5% of the building perpendicular dimension in order to envelope kind of the worst forces that can get to the seismic system, based on the fact that we're not absolutely sure where the center of mass always is. And I agree with that, and I'm certainly not going to state that there's anything wrong with that. But let's look at where this requirement comes from. It comes right out of the vertical distribution of seismic forces section. Now, remember, we just went over that there's two sets of forces that we're talking about that are unrelated to each other. The first one is the vertical distribution of seismic forces. All the forces applied simultaneously to the building to be used to calculate the shear wall forces, whatever the seismic system is, brace frames, moment frames, and corresponding foundations. This accidental torsion section is not found in the diaphragm design section of the code, the separate section of the code that tells you how to design FPX. And remember, those forces are not simultaneous forces. They're not part of the vertical distribution of seismic forces. They're just individual forces at each diaphragm. Now, we can debate back and forth all day long on what the code really means and what you should and shouldn't do, but let's go to the big board and look at the statics of shifting the center of mass arbitrarily.
I set up a very simple statics problem to demonstrate why the diaphragm resultant force needs to match the location of the loading that you put on the diaphragm. I set this up like a beam, but it could be a diaphragm. The reactions could be column reactions, could also be reactions at the shear walls or moment frames or whatever the seismic system is. 100 feet long, 1 kip per foot, I don't think I'd get any disagreement from anybody that the resultant force acts at 50 feet from the left. It's 100 kips, creating a reaction at the left, or A and B are both 50 kips. The shear diagram, 50 kips at each end, and the bending moment, WL squared over 8, also known as the area underneath the shear diagram. Simple stuff, very straightforward stuff. But let's say that someone convinced you that you needed to move this resultant force for one reason or another. Percent over, just moved it over. But you didn't come up with one of the infinite number of new load distributions that would create a centroid over here. Now, if this is really the load distribution you believe, then any other one would really be fictitious and imaginary. Even though there are an infinite number of them, none of them would really be right, because none of them would match what you really believe the mass distribution to be. Okay, let's play this out. This reaction now becomes 45 kips. This reaction becomes 55 kips. The shear goes to 45 kips. This one to 55. And to be anatomically correct, because seem to have a compulsion to do that. So this is now going to cross somewhere not at the middle. Well, not somewhere. At 45 feet. So, first question is, will the shear diagram close? Yes, it will close. Shear diagram will always close as long as the sum of the reactions equal the sum of the forces. So you can have everything wrong and still get a shear diagram that closes, but that shouldn't be telling you anything. Shouldn't get any comfort from that. Okay, now, since we always know that the maximum moment is where the shear crosses zero, if I start at the left and come down, area under the shear diagram creates a moment of 1,012.5 foot kips. I continue on, and what happens? The moment diagram doesn't close. This moment should be zero. There is no applied end moment here. So this is statically incorrect. Let's say I started from the other side. I know, I can fix that. This was zero. I'm going to come down over here and take the area underneath the shear diagram from that side. Come up with an entirely different moment. Nowhere near the 1,012.5 that I had. And I continue on and get that little loop-de-loop. Again, moment diagram doesn't close. The point of this simple exercise is that you can't start shifting the resultant force without really doing some strange stuff to the loading diagram to try to match the resultant location of the loading diagram also. And once you go down that path, I don't know what you're analyzing, but it doesn't resemble the building that we're designing. So your moment diagram will never close unless you are consistent statically. That's my point here. There are examples being generated where I have seen and commented that you cannot shift the resultant force and continue on calculating diaphragm shears and diaphragm moments and cords and drags and collectors. So that's my point. From this point on, we will be statically correct in this example. It is my opinion, our opinion, that the accidental torsion shift does not apply to diaphragms.
Okay, let's start moving this along. The first thing to do is to calculate the center of rigidity of the diaphragm. We've already calculated the center of mass. The east-west center of rigidity, as measured from the intersection of A1, is 150 feet. The north-south center of rigidity coordinate is also measured from the same point, is 83.33 feet. Now we will determine the direct design forces. These forces are just simply divvied up. F sub p is divvied up based upon the rigidity of each member. There is no rotation occurring in the direct design forces. Direct design forces are the rigidity of the particular seismic element divided by the sum of all the rigidities. The seismic elements acting in that direction, or resisting load in that direction, multiplied by the F sub P force. In this particular case, since I did make life easy for myself, all three, wall 1, 2, and 3 direct forces, since they all have the same rigidity, will all share the F sub P force equally, and those walls will each take a 340.33 kip direct force. Now remember, the diaphragm under direct forces is assumed locked against rotation, so it is not rotating here. Let's move on to the rotational forces. The rotational forces are analyzed independently and will superimpose upon the direct forces. The F sub P force is applied at the center of mass. Center of mass, when it is offset from the center of rigidity, that force being applied there will create a torsional moment. Torsional moment acts about the center of rigidity, and the diaphragm rotates about that center of rigidity. Now, I'm not in the habit of deriving things that other people have done a very good job of deriving. This equation exists in a number of analysis books. So I'm just going to copy what other people have done and stick it in my book. The rotational force at any wall is equal to the torsional moment multiplied by the rigidity of that wall times the distance of that wall to the center of rigidity divided by the sum of all rigidities multiplied by their distances squared. R sub I is the rigidity of any wall, D sub I is the perpendicular distance between the center of rigidity and that wall. For our example, with an F sub P force of 1,021 kips and a distance between the center of mass and center of rigidity of 15 feet, we have 15,315 foot kips applied clockwise on the diaphragm. Here's the tabular form of the equation above. Each wall has its own rigidity of 1 here. Like I said, I like to make things easy on myself when I can. This is the perpendicular distance of each wall from the center of rigidity. Each individual rigidity multiplied by its own distance. And again, its individual rigidity multiplied by its distance squared. Those get summed up, and we'll use those in the next equation. Okay, let's calculate the rotational forces. Of course, you can try to keep track of negative and positive distances, and if you're going to write a program like I did, you're going to have to do that to get all the signs correct. When I'm teaching this, when I taught this out at Cal Poly Pomona, I felt it was easiest just to have the students apply the torsional moment about the center of rigidity and simply go to each wall and draw the direction that that wall's force must be acting to resist that torsional moment. Remember, all forces are shown acting on the diaphragm. Torsional moment is acting on the diaphragm. Every force from the seismic system to resist that torsional moment is shown acting on the diaphragm. The F sub P force is acting on the diaphragm. Very important to keep statics correct here. If you look closely, I've just drawn on, I've said what the positive sign convention is, but I've just drawn on the force in the direction that they must be going. Any wall above the center of rigidity must be pushing to the left on the diaphragm. Any wall to the right of the center of rigidity must be pushing up on the diaphragm. Any wall to the left down. Any wall below must be pushing to the right. Okay, there's the torsional moment. This is the R sub I D sub I divided by the sum of R sub I D sub I squared. And the torsional forces are calculated. The final forces on the diaphragm include the direct forces that we calculated previously, plus and minus the rotational forces. Notice also that the perpendicular system doesn't have any direct forces, but it's got rotational forces. If the person next to you is starting to doze off or has been asleep for a while, this would be the right time to give them a sharp elbow to the side if they haven't been as enthralled with the presentation as you've been. This is probably the most important page or slide in this example. First thing to do at this point is to verify statics on the diaphragm. Now, I've been, as I mentioned, reviewing other people's examples and noticing one thing jumping out at me is there's a lack of static checks. If you've ever watched any of my UCLA videos, you notice that we check statics every opportunity we get. It's the way to know that you're on the right track. I had a Cal Poly professor who used to say, "Statics, friend for life," and that's really true. Especially in post-tension concrete, when we start doing equivalent loads and separating out tendon loads on concrete and concrete loads on tendons, really great to go back and just verify statics and get a good comfort level that you're on the right track. Well, that's what I've done here. Some of the forces in the east-west direction, the seismic system perpendicular to the F sub P force in this case. Some of the forces add to zero. Some of the forces in the north-south direction add to zero. And I could pick any point. I picked A1, summed moments about that point, and everything sums to zero, as it should. This is probably the most important diagram in this entire example. This is the shear and moment diagram. Now, this is statically correct, though you might look at it initially and think it might not be. Remember, we have put this line load that we determined on the diaphragm, done our entire analysis based upon this. We've come up with reactions at the seismic system. Now we can draw the shear diagram. And like I said before, even if we're wrong, the shear diagram will actually close. But where it crosses zero, we know we have a maximum moment. So let's draw the moment diagram. If we start from the left and we sum areas underneath the shear diagram, we get a maximum positive moment between grids 1 and 2 of 17,760 foot-kips. Now we continue on over. When we get to the center of rigidity, we're going to stop there. At that point, working from the left, the moment at grid 2, which happens to correspond to the center of rigidity in this example, is 11,185 foot-kips. Move over to the right side and do the same thing and start working in, come up with a maximum positive moment between grids 2 and 3. And it turns out we don't meet up with the 11,185 foot-kips. Now, initially you may think there must be a mistake there. This isn't the same condition as the improper statics example that I did previously. There must be a discontinuity in the moment diagram because the perpendicular system also has loads on the walls and are also creating moments about that center of rigidity. In this case, the offset moment is 3,150 foot-kips. And the moment at the center of rigidity in the perpendicular direction is also 3,150 foot-kips. So we are statically correct. Now, like I said, it's a point of contention there can be a debate about whether or not you take this moment and equally transition it over the entire length of the diaphragm, and you know that becomes the designer's choice. It's up to you, but it's up to me to make sure that this example is statically correct. So that's what I've done. I think this is the conservative way to go because you get a peak, you get a maximum. 14,335 foot kips would be the one that we used, and any averaging would increase this number and decrease this number. So we want to err on the side of conservatism anyway. So this is the way we choose to do it and present it. Up until this point, this example could have been for any rigid diaphragm. It could have been a concrete-filled metal deck in a steel building, non-pre-stressed diaphragm in a concrete building, or a post-tension concrete diaphragm. At this point, we're going to go down the fork in the road of the post-tension concrete diaphragm, though it's not substantially different than doing any other type of rigid diaphragm. The difference is we are going to utilize precompression from the unbonded tendons. Now, the code specifically allows this, specifically states that precompression from unbonded tendons shall be permitted to resist diaphragm design forces. They put a caveat after it that I've always found amusing, if a seismic load path is provided. Now, I'm not sure where in the code you're allowed to use anything seismically when you don't have a seismic load path, so it seems like this is one of those things that goes without saying, but ACI decided to say it. So the question is, we have so much post-tensioning in a building, in a floor, how much of that is available for use to resist diaphragm forces? And that's kind of the trick. That's what we're going to do in the next step, is figure that out. One thing as we're doing that is to keep in mind what I've always taught when I taught reinforced concrete design, advanced reinforced concrete design, pre-stressed concrete design. I always make sure that the students leave my class clear on this. Shear reinforcement always goes in the direction of the load. It doesn't matter what you're designing, if it's gravity loads, if it's seismic loads, it doesn't matter if it's a shear wall or a beam or a slab or a diaphragm. Always remember, shear reinforcement goes in the direction of the load. Flexural reinforcement always goes perpendicular to the load. If you will keep that straight, you'll always be clear about what the reinforcement in the system is doing. Now, with that in mind, we're going to approach that the same way when we look at unbonded tendons and the precompression from those. The precompression in the direction of the load will supplement the shear capacity of the diaphragm. The precompression perpendicular to the load is going to supplement the flexural reinforcement, the cord design of the diaphragm. So let's see how we do this. I've now added columns in the building. You'll see this theme throughout with me. I made life easy on myself. I did 25-foot spans in each direction. I'm assuming a 7-inch post-tension slab. This is very similar to the hotels that we have done in spans and in slab thickness. The loading that I'm using is very similar to what we use in a hotel, 35 pounds per square foot of superimposed dead load. Code required 40 pounds per square foot reducible live load. So here is a typical design strip in the north-south direction. 25 feet wide, all the spans are 25 feet. Because of the symmetry of the building, the answers that we are going to get in the north-south direction will be the same as they are in the east-west direction, so making life a little bit simpler for this design example. So how do we determine how much of the post-tensioning is usable for diaphragm design? Well, we have to start by looking at what our design is for that floor system in the first place. What's the total amount of post-tensioning? Well, when you get to the diaphragm design, you've already designed the floor. So the post-tensioning is done. I've pulled up that run. And this is the run that I've decided to use. This will be what's shown on the drawings handed to the draftsman. Got typically 12.6 kips per foot on the interior bays. At the end bays, 16.8. That results in 150 psi typically on the interior and 200 psi on the end bays. That's not unusual. Balance loads are good. You can see that all the stresses are less than 6 square root f prime c, or you'd be getting asterisks and flags, and the program would yell at you. This is the design that I put on the drawings and hand to the draftsman. Post-tensioning is up here, but the important thing for what we're about to do is down here. This is the non-pre-stressed reinforcement that we are going to provide in the slab. As is typically the case, in my experience in good post-tensioning design, minimums will govern at most areas, and in this case, the 6 number 5s actually is the minimums required, not required by nominal strength, but just minimum steel. In PT data, you're able to input a grid of bottom steel, and this has been predetermined to have number 4s at 30, which is very standard for us. So it won't print that. It will only print what you add to that. So we've got 4s at 30 on the bottom throughout, and added to 4s at 30, we have 7 number 4s in the 2 end bays. So that's the design we're going with, but we need to figure out how much of that post-tensioning is available for seismic design, diaphragm design. In combination with earthquake loads, I'm allowed to reduce the live load factor to 0.5. So I go to the configuration menu, change that to 0.5, and I go back to the force and profile screen. Now what I want to do, and because I have experience in this, I know that I can reduce the post-tensioning by about 25% or so. About 25% of the post-tensioning is typically available for seismic design. So let's, to make it nice and round, subtract 3.5 kips per foot from every bay. Okay, so you can see that these numbers have all been reduced from the actual design on the drawings by 3.5 kips per foot. Now all of a sudden you see that we get warnings about low balance loads and stresses have been exceeded, but none of that matters. Nobody cares in a maximum credible seismic event if concrete cracks or where your balance load is. They want to walk out of the building alive, go home to their families. So surface level stresses don't mean anything. So just ignore those flags. The only thing that does matter, I've already done this example, so I know what the controlling bay is, span 3. The only thing that matters is nominal strength. Now, the way we find out if we have that 3.5 kips per foot available to us is to see if under the new live load factor and reduced post-tensioning, do we still have enough non-pre-stressed seal to support the slabs? Now this is, remember, what we provided, 6 number 5. 6 number 5s is equal to 1.86 square inches of steel. Number 4 is at 30 with 7 number 4s at the bottom is equal to 5.5 square inches of steel. Promise you that wasn't the controlling bay. In the typical interior bay, number 4 is at 30 over 25 feet is 2.0 square inches of steel. So when I go here, I look at what negative steel is required. 1.67 square inches of steel is required. I'm providing 6 number 5s, which is 1.86. I've got enough. Even though I reduce the post-tensioning by 3.5 kips per foot, I still have enough strength to resist factored vertical loads. Likewise, on the bottom, I'm really nowhere near the 2.0 square inches in the full bay that I'm providing. So this proves that I have enough residual capacity to use 3.5 kips per foot or more, but we'll stick with the 3.5 kips per foot, available for the diaphragm design. Back to the diaphragm. Now, it's probably a good time to state that none of the design philosophy that I'm showing you in this entire example and that I put in our book did I develop. There's nothing unique that I came up with in any of this. This is what I was taught. This is what all of us young engineers were taught back when I was right out of school. That was the late 1980s, early 1990s. And I was working at Engelkirk's office, and all of us young engineers would have a set of drawings on our desk, and Seb Ficadeni, who kind of ran the concrete part of this, would come by and show us that, well, this is how diaphragms work. In any concrete design, we assume that emanating off the support concrete failure plane will be a 45 degree. For any shear capacity in concrete, we have the combination of the concrete portion and the steel portion. Concrete portion, according to ACI, is 2 square root F prime C times B times H. It used to be 3 back when we were using the uniform building code. It's now 2, and I'm not exactly sure why that difference, but today ACI says that the diaphragm concrete capacity is 2 square root F prime C, so we'll take their word for it. Just like in any other steel shear design, the steel portion is the capacity of the steel in the direction of load. Remember, I've said shear reinforcement's always in the direction of load that crosses that plane. In post-tension concrete, we are going to ignore that non-pre-stress reinforcement. Even though I have a grid of 4s at 30 in that diaphragm, I'm going to ignore it. I'm going to use the precompression due to unbonded post-tensioning that we calculated in the previous slide. That's really the only difference at this point between being a post-tension concrete diaphragm and being a mild steel, non-pre-stressed concrete diaphragm. So my friends in the academic world will say that it's necessary to provide steel from one end of the diaphragm to the other, and that will be called collector reinforcement. We learned it as drag steel, but today it's collector reinforcement. I kind of like the term drag reinforcement because it's exactly what it's doing. This portion of the diaphragm is trying to go this way. It is trying to go up and launch down the street. The shear walls are attached to the diaphragm, and they're not letting that happen. They are grabbing the diaphragm and holding it back. Well, they're grabbing the diaphragm here, here, and here. That creates a compression zone, say, to the south of those walls, and a tension zone to the north of the walls. So this is really the portion of the diaphragm that needs to be dragged or collected back across this shear plane and dumped back into the compression zone. Now, I always argue that as long as you have concrete capacity, shear capacity, and you have some reinforcement, either unbonded precompression or mild steel, you have collector reinforcement running the full length of the building, even if you don't add any. The question is, do you need to add some? Well, the way you know if you need to add some is, and this is how we do it, there's a variety of ways, I guess we can start debating this now, but we take a conservative approach. We will say that the capacity of this shear plane is equal to the depth of that shear plane is determined by when it runs into another shear plane. So that's as much as you can use. You can't just keep going because you would be crisscrossing those shear planes. Now, we could subtract from the demand on the wall the portion in compression. That's what we do in beams. We say that near the support, the portion in compression doesn't need to be included in the demand. And we could do that here. We conservatively don't do that. We look at the total load required to go to this wall, and we look at the capacity of this plane to resist that. And if we have more capacity than demand, there is no reason to add anything. We're good. There is no additional shear reinforcement. And I say shear reinforcement because that's really what this is. Remember I said reinforcement in the direction of the load is shear reinforcement. Now, you can rename it collector reinforcement. You can rename it drag reinforcement. But what you're really doing is saying, I don't have enough shear capacity in the diaphragm that I have, so I'm going to add some more shear capacity. Now, most of us group this up close to the wall, but you really don't have to do that. You could provide... that's not pretty, but you get my point. You could just increase the reinforcement throughout the diaphragm and get the same effect. You are dragging or collecting this load, and you're getting it back into the compression zone. What I've just explained is the way I've been doing this for almost 30 years. I've discussed this with plan checkers. There's no plan checker that I've ever dealt with that didn't accept this as an extremely rational approach to diaphragm design. And once again, I didn't come up with it. This is what we young engineers were taught. And I've met many engineers and talked to many other engineers. Ross Elena, Ed Workman, Frame Design Group, doing exactly the same thing. Merrill Wallstatt, my dad, you know, people who really work in the concrete industry, and particularly the post-tension concrete industry, are pretty much all doing the same thing and passing on this method, this philosophy, one engineer to another, and passed down from older engineers to younger engineers. And that's what I'm doing right now. And that was all fine until recently, I think, when ACI decided they wanted to start producing diaphragm design guidelines. And they vehemently oppose what I've just said that we do, and have said that you absolutely must run collector steel one end of the diaphragm to the other, or this doesn't have a load path. And I have come back and said, okay, let's look at something like this then. Here's a support, like a shear wall. Here's either a notch joist or beam, but it's analogous to the diaphragm. This sits on this support. It has a failure plane that goes something like this. Now, you've got some reinforcement, I'm sure, shear reinforcement that crosses this. Just like we have some either unbonded precompression going one end to the other, or a grid of shear steel or grid of matte steel, whatever you want to name it. And the question is, there is a shear demand on this, and there's a capacity. And if the capacity is greater than the demand, you don't need to add anything extra. If, on the other hand, you don't have enough capacity for the load that you've got, you'd better start adding more reinforcement. And that is analogous to just adding more collector reinforcement or drag steel. This is just more drag steel or collector reinforcement in addition to what's already there. Now, what are we doing when we extend reinforcement? Let's just take a look at this and say that we're going to take our collector reinforcement out to here. Now, I haven't extended it. We need to turn this load around and see what we have to do going the other way. But for right now, let's just say that this gets it back into the compression zone. By extending additional collector steel out, it's really additional shear steel, we've now extended and changed the shear failure plane. We've added another shear failure plane. We've provided enough reinforcement so that the total shear capacity across this plane is greater than the demand. So that's good. That kind of eliminates this as a place where the diaphragm is going to fail. We bring that additional reinforcement out and we stop it somewhere. Well, when we stop it somewhere, that creates a change in the capacity of the diaphragm. We better check that new failure plane. So by running collector steel out, we've now brought this portion into the compression zone. We've decreased the amount of diaphragm that's in the tension zone that really needs to come and cross this plane. So we will just do a secondary check at that point. We have a new capacity. We have lower demand that's got to cross that plane. And if that works, we can stop that collector steel there. Again, the academic world is absolutely convinced that that's hogwash. I think what they're saying is once you need collector reinforcement, you must continue it one end of the diaphragm to the other. And that, you can do that if you want to be conservative, if you want to put that steel in. There's nothing wrong with it, but I think you should understand that you're being conservative. You really only need to extend collector reinforcement to the point that you don't need it anymore. And I've demonstrated how we would check that. Okay, well that explains the general philosophy of what we're going to do. Now we'll get into the brass tacks of determining, reestablishing what the demand is to each wall and what the shear capacity of the failure plane that each wall has at its disposal is. In summary, here are the three walls resisting lateral loading in the direction of the force we're considering. Here's the force to each one of the walls that we determined from the rigid diaphragm analysis previously. And here are the lengths of the shear planes associated with each one of those walls. Now, ACI, in everything it does, states that the nominal capacity must be greater than or equal to the factored demand. And the nominal capacity is multiplied by a capacity reduction factor. In shear design, we have the concrete portion and the steel portion. ACI 318 says that the concrete portion of the shear strength of a diaphragm is 2 square root f prime c times the shear area. That, with a capacity reduction factor of 0.75, will equal 8.91 kips per foot. Now, instead of using actual steel, we are using the precompression due to unbonded tendons. So, the 3.5 kips per foot that we determined we had available as residual pre-stressing will replace the V sub S here. We'll multiply that by the capacity reduction factor, and that portion gives us 2.63 kips per foot. Added up, the total nominal shear strength of the diaphragm that's usable to us is 11.54 kips per foot. Let's check demand versus capacity. At wall 1, demand force is 380.87 kips, with 54.75 feet of D, the capacity of that diaphragm shear plane is 631.8 kips, much more than the demand. There is no collector required for wall 1. Wall 2 has a demand force of 340.33 kips. This is wall 2. Two. It's got a 92.25 foot failure plane on this side and a 100 foot failure plane on this side, summed up to 192.25 feet of of diaphragm shear plane multiplied by the usable capacity of 11.54, we have absolutely plenty of diaphragm shear capacity at this wall compared to the demand. Again, for loading in this direction, no collector is required to extend north of the wall. Let's go look at the wall in grid line 3. Now, this isn't where you'd want to put a wall, particularly in post-tensioning, but makes for a good example. Demand force is just under 300 kips. The capacity of this very small 25-foot shear plane is only 288.5 kips. It's less than demand. As you might expect, a collector is required, though, as you're going to see, not much. Now, ASCE7 states that when you have a collector, you must design that collector with an overstrength factor. For the building we're considering, that overstrength factor is 2.5. So we'll multiply the collector force requirement, which is the difference between the demand and the capacity, multiply that by 2.5, and we get a 28.2 kip demand for the collector force. That results using 60 KSI steel and a 0.75 capacity reduction factor, and a requirement of 0.63 square inches of steel for that collector. We'll use four number four bars extending north of this wall. So here we're adding the four number four bars. Remember, the best way to think about this, in my opinion, was the first failure plane number one, which drew in the previous slide, did not have enough shear capacity. So we needed to add some shear capacity. And that's what that four number fours are. They're added shear capacity crossing that first failure plane. That gave us enough total shear capacity to resist the load. Well, where do we stop this? How far do we have to extend this? Well, by extending it, we're creating a second shear plane wherever this ends, and that becomes the next critical point to check. Now, at that point, the diaphragm shear capacity has to work by itself, but it now has a longer D, so to speak. The total length required of the shear plane is about 26 feet based upon 11.54 kips per foot. That's hardly extending it past the wall. I think that what that should tell you is that a 7-inch post-tensioned concrete diaphragm, 5,000 psi, is probably the best and most reliable diaphragm that there is. I can think of no other. The fact that it's post-tensioned means the entire diaphragm is in precompression, one end to the other, one anchor to the other anchor, both directions all the way across the building. You may not be sure about the capacity of your diaphragm, but what you can be sure about is that that precompressive force is there. It was there on day one when those tendons got stressed. And unless there's a failure, unless a plumber has come along and started penetrating and breaking your tendons, they're there. They'll be there the entire life of this building, and they will be there during that earthquake. So that's something that you can get a comfort level for. I think that's why post-tensioners would rather use in their calculations the precompression force due to unbonded tendons than they would the rebar that's in the deck. It's something that we become very comfortable is there and usable and at our disposal and reliable. Now, if I'm going to go to the trouble of adding collector force or drag reinforcement, I'm certainly not going to stop it at 1 foot past the wall. This becomes the designer's choice. This becomes something that the designer's just going to have to be comfortable with, make a rational judgment. I would probably pick doubling the length of the wall so that since we're going to go to the trouble of doing this, we'll at least get twice as much shear plane at the secondary shear plane as we had at the first. You may decide you want to run it all the way across the building. that's certainly fine. My point here is to show you that you don't have to numerically. Now, if that helps you sleep at night to do it, then do it. We do that kind of stuff all the time. Comfort steel is better than comfort food. But you don't have to. If I were designing this building and this were my building, I'd probably dimension that to be about 50 feet. Now that we've taken care of the collector or drag design when loads were going south to north, we need to reverse the direction of loading. Now, the reactions to the walls, shear diagram, and moment diagram will all be the same, so there's no reason to redo the rigid diaphragm analysis. Everything will just be reversed. But it's very important that we look at the new shear failure planes. Those will be entirely different. I won't go through this whole process again. I think you've got it. But notice, for instance, that the wall on grid 3, which really had a terrible time when loads were going in the other direction, actually has the longest shear failure plane for loads going north to south. We'll go through the same process, looking at the, counting for the diaphragm shear capacity of 11.54 kips per foot, multiplied by these shear failure planes, and none of the three walls require a collector for loads in this direction. We're going to leave collector design for now. We're actually going to come back to it in a little while, but we're going to leave it for now. We're going to look at the flexural design of the diaphragm. We have the bending moment diagram that we calculated previously, and from that, we will design or check the chords. Now, ACI doesn't use the term chord. Chord is a diaphragm term that those of us who worked in general design offices who designed steel, designed wood, designed concrete, and designed post-tension concrete used to kind of cover all boundary edge design. It's a term that applied in wood and steel, and we use it in concrete. But if you look at the wood code, you look at steel code, you look at ACI, they all seem to use different terminology, which is a source of confusion, I'll be honest with you, in the practicing design firm. I'm going to refer to it as chord design because that's just how I've done this. ACI would call this boundary design. Boundary design is confusing in that it says for shear walls and for concrete diaphragms. Well, those of us who are designing both consider the boundary element check of a shear wall rocking on its edge to be very different than a boundary type of design for a diaphragm. So whenever I hear practicing engineers or building officials use the word boundaries, they're really typically talking about shear wall design. Chords are more often used in the general practicing world to describe diaphragms. Okay, between grids 1 and 2, where we have a deeper diaphragm, we have a bending moment of 17,760 foot kips. Between grids 2 and 3, where we have a shallower diaphragm, different section modulus, we have a bending moment of 16,550 foot kips. Now, the post-tension engineer's perspective on this is that after studying Northridge and looking at diaphragm failures, we are of the opinion that the best diaphragm is the diaphragm that remains elastic, that doesn't experience inelastic behavior, yielding, which then in turn lead to larger diaphragm displacements, and everything attached to that diaphragm, the columns, the walls, go through those large displacements, and that's the real source of the problem of failure during an earthquake. So, from a post-tensioner's perspective, what we really are trying to show is that we have elastic diaphragm behavior under the maximum credible earthquake loads. So we will look at the elastic section properties, the elastic section modulus of the diaphragm between grids 1 and 2, BD squared over 6. we will remember that we had 3.5 kips per foot available in this diaphragm. That is used in either direction. We have a symmetric system. So now we're using it in flexural design. Flexural steel is perpendicular to the load. Remember, I asked you to always remember that. So in the perpendicular direction, we also have 3.5 kips per foot available. That results in 41.7 psi compression in the system. So if we're looking at the tensile side of the diaphragm, the maximum tensile stress between grids 1 and 2 is the moment divided by the section modulus minus the precompression in the deck. That turns out to be 14.7 psi. Now, post-tension concrete people go back to what they know. We check tensile stress against rupture stress of concrete to see if we think it's going to crack. Rupture stress of concrete is 7.5 square root F prime C, or 530 psi, substantially greater than the 14.7 psi that we've calculated. Therefore, what we are saying, and this can get misconstrued, is that we believe this diaphragm, at least in this section between grids 1 and 2, will remain elastic. There will not be any substantial inelastic behavior. Now, I get in debates every once in a while with people from the academic world that are stating, well, in the vertical direction, you have tensile stresses due to bending, just gravity loads and compressive stresses, and even though those are acting perpendicular to the load we're currently looking at, that could result in some localized areas of higher stress. That's all true. But I think what we're showing here is that for the general overall diaphragm, we are confident that its behavior will be primarily elastic, that we are not going to experience inelastic lateral displacements of the diaphragm. So the point is not to say that at no point throughout this entire diaphragm, due to all loading, would we never get close to 7.5 square root F prime C. But in general, on the average, during the earthquake, the diaphragm appears to be behaving elastically. Let's finish this up by looking at the section of diaphragm between grids 2 and 3. We previously calculated the diaphragm bending moment to be 16,505 foot kips. The design in this section is the same as it was between grids 1 and 2. The only difference is we have a shallower diaphragm, which results in a smaller calculated section modulus. So the tensile stress at the edge of the diaphragm, calculated the same way we did in the other section, figuring out the tensile stress due to bending minus the precompression equals 76.2 psi. Again, substantially less than the 530 psi rupture stress. So we conclude that no additional cord reinforcement is required. Now, if this was not a pre-stressed, post-tensioned concrete diaphragm, the designer would approach this by looking at the bending moments, typically designing by dividing by the depth of the diaphragm, maybe 0.95 times the depth of the diaphragm, to come up with a TC couple. And with that T force, equate that to an area of steel required for cord reinforcement. That cord reinforcement would be placed along the edge of the diaphragm, particularly in the long direction of the diaphragm. And you see that on a lot of people's drawings. That's fine for flexural strength. But nowhere in that calculation do you know if the diaphragm is going to behave elastically or inelastically. And in theory, you know, whenever we're using concrete beam type bending theory, we would expect inelastic behavior. That moment divided by D providing an area of steel assumes a Whitney stress block in the compression zone, and you would expect that you might have inelastic behavior. You know, in post-tension concrete design, we really think what we're doing by focusing on verifying elastic behavior is really a superior way to look at diaphragm flexural design, because ultimately that's what is good behavior, is the diaphragm remaining elastic, minimizing deflections, effectively working as a rigid body during the earthquake, and all the things attached to that diaphragm, the columns, the walls, the things that actually fail and then cause vertical collapse, will go through the least amount of displacement. That's the theory. So we do feel like our approach really is a superior way of looking at flexural design of diaphragms. Now, for the next section, I want to talk about where the practicing design industry has created a standard of practice, where the code has some requirements about diaphragm design, but there's really a serious disconnect between what the code says, the interpretation of what the code might mean, and then what practicing engineers are actually doing. So I think we're going to have to go to the big board of knowledge to discuss what I'm talking about.
Okay, we're back at the big board of knowledge. We're winding this down, trying to bring it home. We've got to complete the load path. I want to do that, and then I want to back up and talk about the code, some of the things that are in ACI, some of the things that are in ASCE 7, and how those have been interpreted by those of us in practice. First, let's finish the load path. Now, what we've done is we've pretty much beaten death this diaphragm. We've analyzed the diaphragm, shear moment diagrams, we've checked the collector. I've drawn a simplified diaphragm, checked the collector. We've checked the cord stresses. By the way, I should mention that ASCE 7 does use the word cord. It's ACI that does not use the word cord. Anyway, remember, here is the shear wall. This is probably built a week or 2 weeks before this deck is completed. It's a hardened piece of concrete. It's its own element. Now, we have provided collector reinforcement here, but just in general, in exterior wall, we put collector reinforcement, and this is what it's going to look like. It's still in the diaphragm. It's still in the slab. Collector reinforcement and an interior wall, it's still in the slab. We have got to now connect this piece of concrete to this piece of concrete. Now, I've gotten in a few debates with some engineers, particularly on interior walls, that feel there is no dowel or additional steel requirement in this condition because you have steel from the shear wall passing through. Well, in our opinion, that just doesn't fly. You know, in this case, in this example, you've only got 7 inches of deck. There's no development in 7 inches of these bars. Really what you have is out of plane bending of the bar almost in flexure. It you know, maybe a shear friction, but you're double counting that most of the time. I mean, we use this vertical steel in the wall to check the flexural capacity of the wall. So it's really not fair to come around and use it for shear friction or in any other way in addition to the flexural reinforcement that we're using. So we don't double count those bars. They're probably doing something, but we don't count them. We come in and put in additional dowel reinforcement. Alternated at the interior wall. And to be honest with you, we don't mess around with this reinforcement. We call this out to be at least 3 feet down, regardless of what we calculate it needs to be. It's in a pretty thick piece of concrete. Most of our shear walls are 14 inches or thicker. It's got a nice grid of steel and a somewhat confined core, so we stick this down 3 feet. And regardless of what we think development length is, even a lap length, if you want to argue that that's what it's doing, we stick this out at least 6 feet. not saying everybody needs to, but I feel that this is an extremely important connection. So go down and grab a big chunk of this shear wall and go out and grab a big hunk of that diaphragm, and that's the way to connect these two. This steel, all it's doing is connecting the diaphragm for seismic forces. So it's not being double counted, it's just waiting for the earthquake. Now, okay, how do we design that? This is where one of those areas that's a little complicated with regard to interpreting the code. I'm going to pull this over for a second. I just want you to read this part right here. Second part, ASCE 7. Collector elements and their connections, including connections to vertical elements, shall be designed to resist forces, blah, 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 including an overstrength factor. Now, how this applies to concrete is a little confusing because this steel is not connecting directly to anything. Remember, it's just really additional shear reinforcement, like I keep saying, and it's bringing this load or dragging this load back into the compression zone. So the connection to anything, it's a little unclear. Now, we designed the collector reinforcement and we did use the overstrength factor. I think that's clear in the code. But the question is when it connects to something else. Now, in wood and in steel, I think that's pretty clear what they mean. In concrete, a little more unclear. The question is this connection required to have an overstrength factor? We've run into plan checkers who see it both ways. If it wasn't just such an outrageous amount of steel, we would put that overstrength factor on. But we already calculate number 6 as a 12 as a requirement often, and you're down to having such a tight spacing, and there's other reinforcement in here, and there's post-tensioning anchors, and it's a ridiculous amount looking steel when you get out there and actually take a good hard look at it. So we try to make the argument that this doesn't need to include an overstrength factor. And our logic and reasoning is that in steel design and in wood design, you have a physical drag element, a beam usually connecting directly into the seismic system, the moment frame, the brace frame. In wood, you have a beam framing in and strapped to a wood shear wall. That connection, if lost, is catastrophic. It needs an overstrength factor. And the history and my understanding of it is that overstrength factors are for very, very critical connections. Not that this isn't a critical connection, but we're going to have a whole bunch of these bars along the whole length of this wall. It's not a single localized connection. That's the argument that we've made, and almost all the time, that's a successful argument with a building department. Every once in a while, it's not, and we end up having to put a really unusual amount of dowels in. So, how do we design that? Well, I want to just use the grid 1 wall as an example. That wall has a lateral force to it of 380.87 kips. We're going to use shear friction steel. Now, I made the statement earlier in the program that all shear steel goes in the direction of the load and all flexural steel goes perpendicular to the load. That's always true except for shear friction steel. I didn't want to confuse you back when I said that, but shear friction steel is really its own thing. It's really just shearing a bar physically almost in its own plane. I think it turns and develops into tension, but it's not the traditional shear steel that we've been talking about up until this point. It is shear friction across a plane. This diaphragm's trying to move in and out. We connect one piece to another piece through dowel action, and that dowel action utilizes shear friction. So we'll use shear friction. The new factor in the code is 1.0 for normal weight concrete, placed against roughened concrete. We will roughen this. We'll also key it. And make sure that that connection is solid. We use the 1.0. Calculate the area of shear friction steel that we need. In this particular case, for that particular edge wall, exterior wall, perimeter wall, we will use number 6 is at 15. That provides 8.8 square inches of steel. little bit more than the 8.46 square inches of steel. And now the load path is complete. The diaphragm itself has been designed. We've shown it's going to remain elastic. We've checked flexural stresses. We've checked shear. And we have connected that diaphragm to the seismic system. Now I want to step back and talk about some of the code requirements that can be a little confusing. Here's a simple diaphragm. This side I've made a steel diaphragm. This side I've made a wood shear wall diaphragm. I've designed plenty of both. I worked in a general design firm, did my share of steel design, did my share of wood design, enjoyed it. But these are very much different animals than concrete is. And you learn that as a young engineer very early, that you really can't apply the same philosophy that you apply in steel and wood to concrete. In steel, you primarily have the shear capacity of the metal deck. If you're looking at the roof, that's all you have. You don't have concrete. In a floor system, you'll fill it with concrete, but that concrete is largely unreinforced. It may have wire mesh in it. It may have a very light grid of number 3 bars in it, but it's in corrugated deck, and you don't have a lot of solid thickness in most steel floor systems. What we did then was, if we had a load that needed to get to a moment frame, we divided that load by the entire length of the diaphragm. We pretty much had to, because the shear capacity of the metal deck, or the metal deck even when you include the concrete, is very small relative to a 7, 8, 10 inch post-tensioned concrete deck. This concrete, if you're using it, is usually about 3,000 psi, often lightweight. So it was not unusual at all to need to divide the force by the entire length of the building. That creates a unit shear, that force divided by the full building dimension, and you would build up force. So the force builds up from the edge, connecting through welds the metal deck to the steel element. By the time you get to this point, you've built up a force, you need to bolt across for that force, in addition to the vertical loads that you have from that steel beam. The force builds up again, and it just keeps adding up by the unit shear multiplied by the length until you have a pretty serious bolted connection by the time you bolt to the moment frame or the brace frame. And because you need to use the entire length, the other side is actually working in compression. So you really need to think about that too, the fact that to one side of your moment frame, your seismic system, you've got compression building up. To the other side, you've got tension, and that's how we designed steel floor systems. In wood, it was really the same thing. We've got nails and plywood for a diaphragm, and oftentimes you would need to keep that unit shear down to what was allowable to divide by the entire length of the building. Not at all unusual. Then your collectors are really collecting load. This is where I think the word got developed and makes sense. You're dragging load or collecting load, but largely based on the theory of a unit shear buildup. So you build up to this point, then you Simpson strap across there, and then you build up some more, and you build a bigger strap, and on the other side you're in compression if this is the tension side and load's going that way. So that design philosophy makes sense for literally buildings that are built with stick pieces that have to be connected together. Concrete just isn't that way. It's just a very different material, and diaphragms are very different. My personal opinion is that ACI kind of got caught up with ASCE7, and ASCE7 is written for all diaphragms. It doesn't know if you're talking about a wood diaphragm or a steel diaphragm or a concrete diaphragm. It has very general statements that apply to all diaphragms, and that's very confusing for a young engineer trying to design three different types of diaphragms in their young career. ACI makes the statement that collector elements with compressive stresses exceeding 0.2 F prime C at any section shall have transverse reinforcement, confinement reinforcement, satisfying this section over the length of the element. Well, you know, if you're thinking in terms of steel and wood, that philosophy of building up a compressive stress may make sense. But when you come back and look at how most of us for the last 25 or so years have been designing concrete diaphragms, your compression zone is here. How realistically do you calculate a collector force getting a compressive stress of 0.2 F prime C? Well, that's confusing. That's difficult to interpret on how it is on this type of diaphragm, with your collector reinforcement really just being more added shear reinforcement. Like I said, if you just didn't have enough shear capacity, you added a little more across that failure plane one. You took it out until you had a failure plane two, in which you didn't need any more collector reinforcement. But when the code now says, for that collector, if your compressive stress and the loads reverse exceed 0.2 F prime C, how do you analyze that? And that's not easy, not clear. I've seen people just kind of arbitrarily pick a beam section and then analyze and check it, but you know, it's just kind of an imaginary beam within a slab. Now, as far as actual practice goes, first of all, I wouldn't put a shear wall down in the far corner, particularly in a post-tension concrete building, but if I did, I would build a real beam out some distance, and I would, and I think most practicing engineers would confine it. Whether or not we calculated needing or having 0.2 F prime C, which in the commentary to that part of the code, it says use elastic section properties to determine this. Well, what does that really mean when you're talking about collector or drag steel? That makes a lot of sense when you're talking about cored steel and flexural behavior. We use the elastic section properties like we already have in this example, and we can check stresses. And that's what most of us actually have been doing. This is confusing when applied to collectors. I said, I'm not saying we don't do it and we don't think it's a good idea, but analytically it's difficult to apply that code section if this is how we think concrete works. So if I really was taking a lot of load to the far corner of a building, I would put in a confined beam and run it along the edge of the building. But I think the code needs to get clearer when it comes to concrete on that. Now, what do we really do? Well, for flexural design, for we've got the diaphragm bending like this. We've already checked the tensile stress and shown that we're nowhere near rupture strength of concrete. Well, it's also a good idea. And what most of us have done is have taken that 0.2 F prime C requirement that in the code strictly says for collectors, and what we've done is we've applied it to the cords or the boundary elements. That's where it seems to make the most sense. For those of us who studied the Northridge earthquake, when diaphragm steel went into compression, it buckled right out of the diaphragm sometimes. That's when people used very large bars and fairly thin sections, and we learned that that's not a good idea. In fact, adding a lot of cord reinforcement, a lot of us think is not a good idea. But that's why we do post-tension concrete diaphragms. Anyway, it's a good idea to check the compressive force, and that's an easy check to do in a post-tension concrete diaphragm. I didn't do it in the book. It's one of those things that, after 100 diaphragms and doing that calculation, it never once got close to controlling. I probably should have put it in the book, but it technically is not what the code is telling us to do. The code's telling us to check collector forces. I'm checking chord forces with this. I still think it's the right thing to do. Back when we were checking tensile stresses, we took the M over S. The section modulus is the same in both directions. We subtracted F over A to determine the tensile stress. Well, we're just going to add the F over A to determine the compressive stress. So I take the same numbers we had in the example previously, I turn a minus to a plus, and I calculate that I've got 160 psi, 0.2 F prime C in a 5,000 psi deck is 1,000 psi, 1 ksi. Therefore, there would be no confined chord boundary element required. But if I ever had a really long, thin diaphragm and the parking consultant or architect, whatever building I was doing, just wouldn't give me interior shear walls, I would definitely check this. And if I got anywhere near 0.2 F prime C, again, I would run a confined beam along the edge and put confinement hoops in it. You don't want that section to explode in compression, but like I've said, I've never actually had that come anywhere near close to controlling a design, so much so to the point that I've forgotten about it almost. I don't want to leave the compression in the diaphragm unresolved, so let's go back and look at this one more time. On your screen, you have a nice pretty picture of the diaphragm. On the board, I've attempted to redraw it. Not quite as pretty, but I've done my best. Now, anytime in concrete that we are taking a lot of load and putting it, concentrating it at a support, we need to make sure that we're not crushing or exploding that concrete. Now, for those of us in seismic country, you know, this is the thing that comes to mind first, a rocking shear wall. This is one of the boundary element checks that we do. We look at whether or not we are crushing the concrete at the edge as it rocks up. That is also a 0.2 F prime C type of check. There are other ways using strain diagrams to check that, but the point is there's a heavy localized load rocking on the edge of a shear wall. And again, for those of us who studied Northridge, masonry shear walls immediately pop, spalled their shell. Concrete shear walls spalled their cover. There was often a rubble of concrete down at the bottom here. So it is very important if we are bringing a lot of load to a very localized point to check that. Now, I like to keep an analogy going typically between diaphragms and beams or deep beams. If this were a beam and we were bringing the load to the column support, monolithic concrete, we have the shear plane, the same 45 degree shear plane, and a lot of people model this as a strut, getting this load into the joint of the column. I don't know anybody at this point who actually checks whether or not the concrete is crushing, but it's certainly a legitimate concern. I suppose that if I wanted to check this, I would check some bearing stress of concrete here at this location. But again, I don't think most people do that. Let's go back and look at how all of this would apply to a diaphragm. Well, remember, this is just a 7-inch flat plate, and we've got collector reinforcement in that 7 inches. Now, I hope nobody's solution to this is to say, I've got a great idea, let's just always put beams in a flat plate system and drag and collect load to a shear wall. That's the wrong answer. And we've made huge inroads into every type of construction. We do hotels, we do condominiums, we do parking structures, we do assisted living facilities, we do medical facilities, flat plates. It was really the invention of the stud rail, the shear studs, that allowed us to eliminate caps and make the system completely flat. And that opened up the entire world for us. We have a system that can be 7 or 8 inches deep. There is no other system in steel, wood, anything else that can be that thin and work. And I will say it again, I believe that flat plate diaphragm to be the superior diaphragm of all diaphragms. I even think in beams and in one-way slabs that's true, because the one-way slabs really thin down the section that's the continuous diaphragm. So in a flat plate system, you have a thicker, continuous system. I believe this with all my heart to be the most superior system that there is. But don't come along and tell us that we've got to add beams to get loads, seismic loads, through diaphragms to places, or you will literally put us out of the market for everything except long span parking structures. So let's address the concern. I'm going to do this as conservatively as I can. I will be honest with you, at some point in my career I probably checked this once or twice and got myself convinced that this is not going to be a problem. I only have 25 foot long walls in this example. Typically our bays are 30 feet and I would never make a shear wall shorter than one bay. So most of our walls will be 30 feet or substantially longer. But in this case we've got 25 foot long walls. Let's do the most conservative thing we can. Remember, this wall took the most load, so I'm looking at the controlling condition, the 380.87 kips. If I decide that I want to look at this as a strut, and I increase that force because I decide that this is a component of a larger strut, I increase that by the square root of 2 because I'm assuming this is coming in at 45 degrees, which has been a consistent assumption that I've been making through the entire diaphragm analysis. And I even get more conservative and I decide that this is pinching down because the area that I can count on, and remember I'm counting on this 25 feet and just this 25 feet only because that's the dowel connection. That, I have it back here, that's the connection, this is where the transfer is happening. That's where the load transfer is occurring. It's through those dowels. It's connecting one piece of concrete to another piece of concrete. So that's where the load is localizing. Whether or not I have something I call collectors, they're really not participating, in my opinion, in what we're looking at here. Collectors or no collectors, all of these walls are getting a compressive force through the dowels at a 45 degree, if we're making that assumption. So I'll even go over an area that's 1 over square root of 2 times the length of that wall to be what I think is pretty conservative. So let's check that. Again, making some conservative assumptions, I take that 380.87 kips, I increase it by the square root of 2, I divide by the length of the wall, the thickness of the slab, the diaphragm, and I decrease that area by 1 over square root of 2, and I come up with a grand total of 363 psi, only a third or so of the allowable compressive stress that the code says I have. So even looking at it this way, and we're really not localizing load to a specific point like we would in a different type of diaphragm. These are coming in equally through dowels spread along the length of the wall. So it's not this condition, it's really not even this condition. It's 25 feet of distributed dowels that we are taking a load to. So, you know, I didn't want to leave you hanging with respect to that. That's really, again, not collector, not checking a collector. In a 7-inch plate, we're not going to be able to provide confinement steel anyway, so that would force a beam, and again, we don't want to do that. That's not the right answer. We already have the best diaphragm in the world. Yeah, beams would make it better, but beams would shove us right out of the markets that we're in, so we're not going to do that. Looking at this, we're really nowhere near crushing any concrete, in my opinion. I'm not aware of any earthquake that's resulted in in crushed concrete, transferring load from a substantial post-tension diaphragm correctly doweled to a wall. So I think we've addressed really what the code's intent is. We didn't address anything about the collector reinforcement in this, but I think we got to the intent. And I think that covers it. I believe we've covered now the entire load development, load path, rational solution to a flat plate diaphragm. This was post-tension, but that really was a very minor part of this. We, instead of using bonded reinforcement for shear and for cord checks, we used precompression due to the unbonded post-tensioning. That's really the only difference between a non-pre-stressed and a pre-stressed diaphragm. So there it is. I didn't intend that this was the end all for diaphragms. It may actually create more questions than it answers, but that's okay. It may be time for a good discussion between the people writing the building codes and those of us who've been designing diaphragms for 25 years or so, and passing that information between all of us engineers down to younger engineers. Probably time to reconcile between the code writers and the practitioners. But that's it. Thank you for listening, and happy designing diaphragms.